Ladies and gentlemen, this is Joe's Video Games, back with another really cool arcade game we figured we'd film a video of. Today is one of the most famous pinball machines of all time, Bally's 1977 8 Ball. If you've never seen it, today is your lucky day, because we've got one here. This is a pretty special machine. It stands as one of the best-selling of all time. Of course, it's the famous one with the Fonz on the back. Or it's not really the Fonz, but he looks just like the Fonz. 8-Ball. So this came out in 1977 and was one of the first solid-state games. So before that, you know, the games looked like this. They had the little electromechanical score reels. They were a little more simple. Of course, this particular one's really simple, but so they couldn't... They didn't have any kind of PCBs or any kind of computer integrated circuits or anything in them. And then all of the companies that were making pinball machines were kind of in a race to start that first. So you had Bally of note, you had Stern, you had Williams, and you had Gottlieb. So Stern, I think, had one out before Bally did. And Stern kind of copied Bally's board design, which I'm not sure how they did that before it came out, but... I'm wrong about that. Bally had the first ones out because they had about four games out before this one. And then Stern copied the board design and put out Stern Pinball was the name of their first solid-state game. But Bally had a few out. So they did one called Freedom in 1977 and a couple more. And then they did Evel Knievel. And the Evel Knievel pinball machine was really a pretty good seller. There was one, too, that they did called Knight Rider that's really fun. If you've never played Knight Rider, it's a fun game. But basically, they were similar to EMs. You know, this is before ramps and everything, but they just used computer boards to run everything instead of all of the relays and stuff. So this was all still pretty new. And then Bally came out with this one, 8-Ball. So the special thing about 8-Ball, this would have been, you know, just a few months after they came out with solid-state games. So this would have been one of the first ones people saw, you know, over the course of a couple months, a few of these rolled out. And then this one came out, and it had one little thing that none of the other ones had done yet. It actually used the memory chip on the game board for the first time. So, like, there's a RAM chip on the board, you know, like modern computers and stuff have. There's just a little chip that can save a little bit of memory. And so the way they used it was, whenever they had EM games, they had a little problem. On an EM game, if you played a one-player game, and let's say you got, you know, on this game, we'll use this card theme. Let's say you got the Jack, the Queen, and the 10 lighted, and the object of the game is to get all of them. Well, whenever the second player started, you had a problem because the Jack, the Queen, and the 10 would be lit up from the first player. So they would either leave it like that so that the second player could steal the work you'd done, or they would just reset it at the end of each ball. They couldn't reset it for the second player, so he starts just like the first player did with a blank slate, and then put it back how it originally was for the first player. So a lot of EM games, after you played at the end of each ball, it would reset everything. It would reset all of the bonuses and all of the, you know, games like this, wherever you were trying to collect a certain number of things. Well, this is a pool theme, so basically you're trying to collect the pool balls with different shots. Well, they would on the games before, they would have to reset that at the end of each ball or hold it over so that the second player could already have your pool balls lit up. But on this one, with the memory chip, with the RAM chip, they could remember where you were. So like, if I get ball 1 and 7 and then the second player gets ball 15 and 13, when it goes back to the first player, 1 and 7 will light up again. And that sounds real minor now, but back then that had never been done. So that was a really big deal, and people really liked it and flipped out about it and just thought this was a really cool game. And then there was the back glass. All right, I had to stop for a second. We had a bunch of customers come in. So I was going to tell you about the back glass. So this came out again in 1977. And one of the biggest shows on TV in 1977 was Happy Days. So Bally released this machine, just a complete rip-off of Happy Days. So that's obviously the Fonz playing pool, looking at you. And that is the Fonz's famous girlfriend on the show, Pinky Tuscadero. Obviously. Looks just like her. Then in the back, this guy looks kind of like... He's kind of like Richie, because Richie always wore the letter sweater like that. But he kind of looks like Potsy or something. I don't know. I don't know who that guy is. And then Bally also made a copy of the Wurlitzer jukebox and put their name on it. And then you got this guy over here, who looks like he's inappropriately touching that chick. Now, if you remember, if you know much about your Happy Days history, Laverne and Shirley were minor characters on the show, and then they got their own show. Well, Bally, whenever asked about it, said that this was, they called this lady Laverne on the back glass. This guy kind of looks like the guy from Laverne and Shirley. I can't remember his name. And then over here, I think she, you know, I don't know, maybe she's supposed to be Joni from Happy Days. And of course, they're playing a little pinball machine there. So just excellent art. I mean, this stuff is really iconic. Everybody knows that back glass. And then on the playfield, you've got interesting art too. So here on the right, you've got Pinky again, looking good. Here on the left, you've got the Fonz again, looking good. And then presumably the Fonz's hand. And then again up here. Chalking the pool cue. And then Pinky again up here. And then even the Fonz's motorcycle makes a cameo. So the artwork was just awesome, I think. And then on the cabinet too, forgot about that. He's on the side of the cabinet, kind of a stylized depiction. And again, these were stenciled, so they would have just held up a cutout, sprayed different colors on it. On the back, 8-ball. We've touched this up a little bit. This thing isn't in mint condition, but we like it. I think it looks pretty nice. Then you've got the 2 8-ball graphics on the front. And then the art on this side is a mirror image of the other side. Now, a lot of people have said that Bally was sued by Henry Winkler over this, who played the Fonz on the show. That's not true. There was never a lawsuit. We don't even know for sure if he ever even complained about it. He may have, but if he did, it was handled out of court, because they never lost a lawsuit on this. And you've got to remember, there were, you know, at the time, there weren't really that many games that were licensed, so it wasn't really, it wasn't like they could have licensed it and they ripped them off. I'm sure they could have, but the first licensed game that was really popular was Kiss, which came out probably a year later, maybe 2 years later. So at the time, not only did they not license it, there weren't very many licensed games around then anyways, if there was any. So things are different back then than they are now. If you tried that crap now, you would really get... you'd definitely end up in court. And he may have said something about it, I don't know. And similar, you hear people say the same thing about Space Invaders. The Space Invaders pinball machine had a big alien on the back glass that was obviously a ripoff of the Alien series, the movie. But they were not sued over that either. People think that they lost a lawsuit. They didn't. I believe the artist did complain about it, but it was settled out of court, and they, people believed that either they came to an agreement of, you know, paying him, or that they gave him a few free pinball machines. And people have said the same thing about Henry Winkler, that even if he did complain, the way it probably got handled was Bally gave him a couple machines or something. So if anybody knows the real story, and I don't mean the story you heard on the net, I mean the real story, please respond to the video and tell us the real story. So this game is very simple, but very, very fun. Let me tell you how fun it is. It's so fun that this is the third best-selling game of all time. That's how fun it is. Now, you'll read a lot of people online that don't like the game, and they will all have the same reason that they don't like the game. It's too hard, because the ball can drain a lot, or you know, you can miss it through the middle. But it's a very simple game and was very popular whenever it came out. And it wasn't just because Happy Days was one of the big shows on TV, and it wasn't just because it was the first game that used the ball memory feature that we were talking about. It's because it's a fun game. So this game, whenever it came out, sold 20,230 copies. That's a lot, folks. That's a real lot. Evel Knievel sold about 14,000, was incredibly successful. But this sold over 20,000 copies. 20,230 copies in 1977, and I'm sure it would have went on into 78 because it would have took them a long time just to build all those. And then in 92, when the Addams Family came out, Addams Family Pinball, which is another excellent pinball, sales kept going and kept going and kept going, and it became apparent that they were going to outsell the legendary Bally 8 Ball, right? So Bally arranged for the 20,230th, hope I got that number right, machine, Addams Family machine, the one that would beat this one for the sales record. That's a flipper sales record. We'll talk about that in a second. They arranged that whenever they made that one machine that beat it, they had it in a gold cabinet. So you can get an Addams Family with gold art on it and gold rails, gold trim. And then they made about the Addams Family game, they made about 40 more in that run, and some of them had some gold accents on it, and a couple of them even have gold art on the bottom and the standard blue art on the top. So Addams Family outsold this game, but it was the only one that did. Very popular game. My point is, if this game isn't any fun, how in the world did they sell 20,000 of them? It made a lot of money because it's real challenging, so a lot of people liked the game. But then also it was really good for operators because it the games wouldn't last that long. It was a very tough game, depending on how it's set up. So it's a very successful game, very fun game in my opinion if you play it. Very simple though, there's not much to do, but it's a solidly designed game in my opinion. And so we're talking about sales figures. So there is one game that outsold the Addams Family and outsold 8 Ball combined. In the 20s, they released this game called Ballyhoo. And it was, you know, early pinball machine. Of course, no back glass or anything. It wasn't even electronic, I don't believe. It might have had batteries in it. But just a simple little cabinet with some simple shots. But it revolutionized the way pinball was done. This was way before they ever invented the flipper. And they don't have exact records, but they believe that Ballyhoo pinball sold 100,000 copies, making it the best-selling pinball machine of all time. Now, in the flipper era, games that you know we traditionally think of as pinball machines with flippers, this is the second best-selling, the best-selling of the 70s, and was only bested by the great Addams Family pinball machine. So I'll go over the gameplay just a little bit. Very simple game. Instructions, here we go. First and third players play the solid balls, 1 through 7. Second and fourth players play the stripe balls, 9 through 15. So if you look on a play field, you've got this rack in the middle. Whenever you start a one-player game, the 1 through 7 balls all light up. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4 up there. And you can see below it, 9, 10, 11, and 12. Those would light up if you're the second player or the fourth player. Over here is the 8 ball. These are some bonus lights that can be lit up with this bank shot, as they call it. Over here is the 5 or the 13. Over here is the 6 or the 14. And then over here you've got the 7 and the 15. So basically, you just try to make all the different balls. So if you're the first player, you try to make 1 through 7. When you make 1 through 7, it lights 8. So you try to make the 8 ball shot. That 8 ball shot, that same target, also lights the kickback ball save over here. So you've got a kind of wide lane here on the left that you'll see a lot of people complain about. But the reason they did that was because there's a save over here. There's a little coil that pops out and saves the ball if you've lit it up by hitting the 8 ball. So a strategy that you might take is you start the game and then you immediately try to hit that 8 ball. Because if you do that, it'll save this left out lane for you. And then you try to get line up all the balls. If you get all of them, it'll light up the 8 ball and then you can get the 8 ball. All right. 8 ball target lights when all solid or all stripe balls are made. So if you're the second player, you do the same thing except you use balls 9 through 15 and then it lights up the 8 ball. Making the 8 ball lights the right out lane to score special. So if you make 1 through 8, it lights up that special light, which gives you a free game if you get it. It could have been set up to give you a free ball, depending on how they have it set. All right. But on this game, it says one play for ball through the right out lane when lit for special. So that's how this one's set up. Player making the eight ball qualifies for super bonus on his or her following ball in play. So let's say you're playing a two-player game and you make one through eight on the rack. Well, it lights up this collect bonus here, which is actually super bonus. I'm sorry. It lights up this super bonus light the next time you play. So it's another way that they were able to use the memory thing to carry it from ball to ball. So after it counts down your bonus, if you had one through eight, it remembers that, and whenever it goes to your next ball after the second, third, or fourth player plays, or if it's just a one-player game on the very next ball, it lights up that super bonus, which means you're going to collect that whenever the ball drains on the next ball. Okay, tilt penalties, ball in play, maximum one extra ball per ball in play, one replay for each player matching the last two score numbers. That's just the match thing. Three replays if you beat the highest score achieved to date. So you've got this bank shot over here. Every time you make it, there's a little rollover right there so it can tell that the ball went through there. And every time you do that, it advances this. So at first, it's worth 300 points. The reason it's already on 600 is because we have this ball set up for three ball. If it was set up for five ball, it would make everything a little bit tougher. But it's a little easier because you don't get as many balls. Second time, 600, and it says lights two times. So that means two times your bonus. Each ball is worth $3,000. I mean, 3,000 points that you've already lit up. And if you've got it, if you've lit two times, three times, to five times, it doubles, triples, or quintuples it. So each time you make this shot, that goes up higher and higher and higher until you get up to an extra ball and 5,000 points. And then you get 100 points on the pop bumpers. So very simple game. That's all there is to it. You got a nice spinner shot over here. And that's it. Simple as that. But really fun. It's a pool theme. People love them. It's just now there's other pool games that people like a little better, but at the time, for what it was, this thing was incredibly successful. So we'll play through it a little bit and just show you how it plays. A lot of people get frustrated with this game because the balls don't last really long. It's not a modern type machine where you can play on a ball for 2 or 3 minutes. If you're good enough, you might lose the ball right down the middle because the flippers are a little bit far apart. You know, you might lose the ball down this left out lane if you don't have it activated to save it. And you could easily lose the ball over here. This lane here is a tough one to make that in lane, because when the ball goes through there, you got about a half and half chance that it might go out the out lane and you lose the ball. And it's not really set up, that's so steep right there that it's hard to catch the ball and make it roll up the bottom and hit the switch like you can do in a lot of games. So you'll see a lot of people complain that they don't like that the ball time is so short and there's not much to do and blah, 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 blah. But, again, the numbers don't lie. So I'll get the tripod and we'll play it a little bit. Okay, so we're going to play through it a little bit. Now, this game was so early, they didn't even have a soundboard, an electronic soundboard in it yet. So this thing has chimes. But it was kind of a, you know, some people don't like the chimes. They like the bells better, and some people like the chimes better than the bells, and some people like Gottlieb's chimes better than Bally's chimes. But we're so far removed from it now that hearing any game with chimes is pretty cool, in my opinion. And this was a neat one. A lot of games only had three chimes, but this one had four chimes. So that was considered very advanced back then, right? So basically, the way I'm going to play, or try to play, because I'm not, you know, as you guys all know, and girls all know, I'm not a great pinball player. But if you hit the eight ball, it makes it where your shot gets saved if it goes out there. So I'm going to try to hit the eight ball, and then I'm going to try to collect the targets. So we'll see. We'll see how it goes. If you notice, it gave me the two and the three ball whenever I went through just one. That's because it's set on three ball. So it makes it a little easier for you. Ooh, boy, it's playing with that one target. It lightly hit it. There we go. So I hit the eight ball and it gave me the, all right, so I got the five ball. All right, we're doing pretty good, actually. Oh, saved it. Oh. And then I hit it again. Oh, saved it again. Not bad, really. So the reason it gave me the two and the three is because it's on three ball. So if you set it on three ball, they give you some suggested settings on the dip switches on the board, which change some of the settings. So basically what that does is it makes it where the top rollovers double up. So now if I get one or four, it'll like both of them, and then that'll complete my rack of seven so that it just wants me to get the eight ball after it lights up. Yeah, baby. I see how the eight lit up. There we go. So I've got the whole rack now. So I'm going to try to just get tons of points. I'm going to try to make that bank shot several times if I can help it. There we go. Because it'll keep increasing my bonus. Oh, man, I got the special, though. Now, if you'll remember when I was telling you the rules, since I got the rack of eight on your next ball around, even if it's a multiplayer game, it lights up super bonus. So I've already got that lit. You don't have to do anything to get it. You're just going to get that added to your bonus whenever the ball drains. So that's an extra 24,000 points. My score right now is 130,000. And this thing is set up. You know what, though? I don't think I set up the replay. I might have to go back into that. But it looks like normally it would have been set up for 180,000 to get a free game. You'll see people online complaining that, oh, I never get it. Whenever I play that, I never even get to hit the ball. It just goes straight. It drains as soon as it shoots out. Well, as you can see, I'm not even very good. And there's plenty of action on this game. You just have to have it set up well, and you need to rebuild the flippers. You know, you're going to get stuff like that where it's straight down the middle, but the game wasn't meant for you to be able to completely control the ball the whole time. Awesome. It gave me the rack again because I guess it holds it over. So after I got the eight and the ball drained, I guess it let the let me go through it again, but then it counted down again on the next ball. So that's awesome. All right, so that's 210,000 points. The reason you heard it knock three times is because that's the best game I've ever had since I replaced the batteries in it. And if you beat the high score of all time on the machine, you get three free games. Now, that's not 210,000 is not a very good score. Anybody that owns this game could probably smoke me, but it ain't bad. We'll try it again. This is one of those games that's kind of a just one more game. You play it, and then after you know, if you don't do quite as good as you want, you think, let's just play one more game, and you hit start again, you know? So, you know it's a decent game whenever you've got that desire. All right. Knock that out. That's the end of that. Whoop. Oh, I didn't have my insurance lit up. Come on, eight ball. Don't you just love a good spinner shot? I mean, that's awesome. Yeah. See the light? See the arrow up at the top in the middle? If you get it, it advances the bank shot over on the right. which, you know, that shot over on the right, the bank shot, is what gives you your double and your triple and all that. So that's a really good one to advance. We rebuilt the on this particular game, we rebuilt the flippers and got them nice and strong. You know, you got to properly adjust your kickers here I guess they're just called kickers. You got to properly adjust those so they're nice and strong. So you'll see every once in a while it'll kick up and hit the target for me. And then we rebuilt the pop bumpers, which we don't always do. But on this one, the skirts, the little red parts that you're seeing, those were originally white. I'm pointing at it right now. Those were originally white, and they were all chipped up just from years and years and years of play. All right, so I need the six, which is that target over there, which is a hard shot for me. It's always hard for me to make the wide shots, but I need the six, and then it'll light the eight ball. We're on ball two. I think what I'm going to do is just go for the spinner again. Oh, right by me. And we waxed the play field, so it's going fast, and we've got it. We always put them at a pretty steep angle. Not crazy steep, but, you know, it's got a little bit of a incline on it. If your flippers are rebuilt, they're nice and strong. You can set these old Bally's up pretty steep, and they'll play fine. Six is a hard one to make because you can't even cradle on the left. You can't cradle the pinball like you can on the right because you can sometimes, but usually you can't because it'll roll up and over. All right, we're gonna play one more. Oh, come on. And you'll notice I don't nudge the game much because I'm not good at that. But a lot of people, you know, they'll nudge it and try to get the ball to go where they want and everything. That could really help you on this game, I think. Oh, about missed it. Come on, six and seven. I had to break my nudge band there. I almost lost it. Oh. This is one of those games too with the chimes. The chime, every time it hits the chime, a little coil hits the chime bar. It's like a xylophone, basically. And if you really get going and you're getting a huge score going, the chime will get behind because it takes it about half a second every time it hits it. So it'll go, and you'll hear it just keep doing it, and the ball won't even be hitting anything, and the chime will still be going and going and going. And if you really get it rolling where the points are really racking up and it's way behind, I mean, that thing will chime for 20 seconds trying to catch up. Oh, that six is the hardest one for me. The seven's hard too. All right, we're gonna play one more. Here we go. Seven that I needed. So I gotta get the two extreme. Oh, I missed. I'm trying to hit the five. But to hit those, you know, you have to let the ball roll all the way down to the end of the flipper. Oh, that didn't help me. You have to let the ball roll all the way down for it to be wide enough to hit it. It's hard to do. There we go. Preset bonus for me. Oh, I think I went around too so fast on that one that it didn't hit the target. There's my six that I needed. Ooh, got that just in time. Oh, come on. So all I need is my five. Oh, I got lucky there. Need to light that again. Okay, I did. Good. Oh, missed. Oh, I got it. Cool. Okay, now I need to get the eight. Woo! Glad I had that again. Let's see if we can slide it through there. There we go. All right, now it's just points time. I need to really make that horseshoe shot some more. Oh. $162,000. Not as good as my first game, but not bad. So there you have it, folks. There's a little video of Bally's 8 ball, if you don't remember what it was like. This thing was built in 1977, and as we stand here tonight, it's 2015. That's a long, long time. So that's what? 38 years, right? If my math's wrong, correct me below. But 38 years ago, and this thing is still playing good, and it's got the original boards in it. We didn't put new updated boards in it. We just fixed the ones that were in it. So it's got all the original stuff and still doing its thing. These Bally's were pretty well designed, except for the battery issue that everybody knows about on the main board. But if that's not too bad, you can fix it. So that's what we did with this one. Now, by the time you see this video, Mr. 8 Ball may have, moseyed on over to a new juke joint in town. But maybe we'll have something else that you're interested in buying. If you're looking to buy a game, you can check out all of our games on our website at lionsarcade.com. Or you can stop by and see us. We're in downtown Rock Hill, South Carolina, which is about 15 minutes south of Charlotte, North Carolina. And we've got a whole room full of stuff like this, mainly arcade games, but we get one or two pinballs a month usually is what we usually try to get done. They take a lot of work just getting every little thing working the way it should. And if you're not interested in buying a game, or you don't live near here where you can stop by and hang out, just subscribe to us here on YouTube. We're going to be getting in tons more games. We've been doing this for many years, and we just haven't been filming for very many years, but we started filming pretty much everything that we get done that's a decent machine. So we'll have many more videos. Just subscribe to us here on YouTube, and that'll send you an email every time we put up another video of something different that you might be interested in. And we will see you next video.